You talking to us?
Oh, sorry,
Welcome.
sorry.
Welcome to the Foul Play YouTube channel.
Thank you very much, Jack61. Thank you for that introduction. And welcome, everyone. It's so great to be here. Thank you for joining us in our weekly podcast entitled Reading with the Crew. And we're on part 19 at the moment. And so for those who are following us in chat, we're actually on chapter 23 entitled Ken Kratz. And as you all know, what we're doing is we are reading selective passages from John Farrakh's book, from the Reading Crew. And I just want to say to everyone before we start that these represent the thoughts and ideas of John Farrakh. They don't necessarily reflect our opinions, and it's very important that you guys do your own research and reading and come up with your own conclusions. Well, today, guys, is going to be part three, and hopefully we can finish this part today. So thank you for joining us in chat. What we're going to do is we're going to start straight away. And remember, guys, we're doing this podcast in the memory of Teresa Halbach, who was tragically and brutally taken at just the tender age of 25 years old, very likely on Halloween, October the 31st, 2005. Guys, we also do this because we believe in the innocence of both Stephen and Brendan Dassey, who are in prison for life. We believe that they were not involved in the murder of Teresa Halbach. So welcome, guys. My name is Dr. Silkman, and I'm from the Foul Play team. And let me just quickly introduce our esteemed panel today before we actually commence the podcast proper. We have Jack61. Welcome, Jack61.
Thanks, Doc. Hello, panel, and everyone in the live chat. It is a balmy -3 Celsius, which is, you know, 26, 27 degrees, and snowing.
Oh, my God. Thank you very much, Jack61. Next, we have Alice. Alice, how are you coming along?
Hi, everyone on panel. Hi, everyone in chat. Yeah, not too bad, Doc. Jack, I'm not as cold. I'm sitting at 3 degrees or so. I'm the same as you, bar the minus, and it's still bloody freezing here. We're expected ice and snow as well, so.
Unbelievable. Thank you so much, Alice. Next, we have, I don't recall, how things coming along.
It's not really cold here. We're kind of between snowstorms right now, so all is quiet. And hello, everybody. Welcome to Reading with the Crew.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. I don't recall. Next, we have Neville. How things coming along?
Hello, Dr. Silkman. Hello, panel. Hello, everybody in the chat. Doing great. Beautiful day. 68 degrees. Don't hate me. I have no control over that. And it's just a beautiful day in Neverly Hills.
Oh,
welcome.
God. Thank you very much, Neverly. We're not jealous, of course. We're not jealous. Thank you very much. And finally, we have Sunshine Christina. Welcome, Sunshine Christina. How are things coming along?
Good. Thank you, Dr. Silkman. Hello, panel. Hello, chat. It's not 68 in Florida, but it surely isn't -3 either. So I'm grateful for that and looking forward to this discussion.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Sunshine Christina. Well, I'm from Adelaide, South Australia, the land from down under. And it's around about 20 degrees, a bit cloudy, but the weather's really, really nice. And we've had Jess Rhonda join us. Jess Rhonda, welcome. How are things coming along?
Oh, thank you. Things are going okay. Got a busy day today, so I'll be kind of in and out, but I'll stay
here you
as
are.
As I can.
Awesome. Awesome. Thank you so much for joining us. Well, look, guys, we're going to make a start to the podcast. But before we do, we'd like to warn everyone of potentially the use of colorful language by some of us on the panel. This is a very emotive case, and certainly we're talking about everyone's favorite prosecutor, Mr. Kratz. Now, as you know, Mr. Kratz held a very volatile press conference. But trust me, that's not the only thing he did. And we're going to have a look at this in the preceding chapter. Also, guys, please note that sometimes members of the family come and join us in the chat. Please be respectful to whoever comes in, right? It's not an easy situation when you have potentially Barb in chat. She's got her own son and brother in prison for life for something I believe, and all of us on the panel believe, that they did not do. So, guys, please be respectful. If you've got a favorite topic that you want to discuss, hey, please come to Discord. If you check our video description, we have a lot of different services that we do, a very extensive website, very extensive Discord channel. Well, look, guys, so not to waste any more time, let's restart the chapter. Neville, are you ready to go? We're on page 17. Now, remember, this is Gershman who's doing an analysis on Mr. Kratz's performance as a prosecutor. Thank you very much, Neville, whenever you're ready to start. Thank you, guys.
Well, let's go. But since Kratz was not a man of ethics or integrity, let me repeat that. But since Kratz was not a man of ethics or integrity, he also had no shame in writing a book intended to sabotage Avery's long-term prospects of ever getting justice and a new trial. Part of the information that Kratz contained in his 2017 book, The Case Against Stephen Avery and What Making a Murderer Gets Wrong, came from information that Avery's trial judge, Patrick Willis, had sealed and therefore was not part of the court record at the time of Avery's trial. Kratz's book and media appearances describe a vivid detail how he claims Avery sexually assaulted his ex-wife, his former girlfriend, his niece, his babysitter, his horrific torture of a cat, and a variety of other violent criminal acts. Gershman said. Sorry. Indeed, these allegations parallel the inflammatory allegations Kratz made against Avery in his sealed motion to Judge Willis.
Now, Neville, if you could just halt there. Now, a lot of people may not be aware of this, but what Mr. Kratz wanted to do, right, Jack 61, right, guys, was introduce a whole variety of charges that occurred in Stephen Avery's past. He wanted to introduce it as part of the court record. Right, Jack 61?
Yeah, he tried twice. And Willis shot him down. He said, no, we're not doing it.
Yeah, and Judge Willis shut it down. He sealed the documents. Well, we just happen to have what those allegations are. So, Jack 61, are you able to fast forward to the next page? So what we'll do, we'll read what those allegations are, and then we'll get back to page 18. Alice, can you see that page with the allegations? Alice, can you see them?
Come on. Yes, Doc.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
I can.
Yeah. Yes. Are you able to read? Can you see them?
Yes.
Okay. Are you able to read the next two pages? These are the allegations that Mr. Kratz wanted to introduce in court.
Okie dokie. The state is seeking to introduce evidence of other acts of the defendant at the trial in the above entitled matter. The state offers this evidence to prove motive, intent, preparation, plan, and identity. Specifically, the state seeks to introduce evidence of prior acts of the defendant, including 1. Prior acts of physical violence and threats. A. Against ex-wife Laurie Avery. B. Against girlfriend Jodie Stachowski. C. Violence or cruelty toward an animal. D. Endangering safety against Sandra Morris. 2. Prior acts of sexual misconduct. A against MA, date of birth 6/14/1987, and B JAR, date of birth 11/9/1964. Number three, prior sexual history with girlfriend Jodie Stokowski. Number four, prior act of being a felon in possession of a firearm.
And this is the last one on 18B.
Number five, the other evidence of motive and targeting a victim, including a telephone conversation with Marie Littersky on October 30th, 2005, requesting that she come to Stephen Avery's residence to have sexual intercourse with her.
All right. So these are the additional information that Mr. Kratz wanted to introduce during the trial. Has anyone got any comments on those? Sunshine Christina.
First off, is J.A.R. the babysitter? Or are we thinking that? Okay. And then.
Yep, I believe it is.
Wow. Talk about trying to make mountains out of molehills. I'm like, wow. It's reading it. And knowing what we know about every one of these, the prior acts of physical violence and threats, there's no criminal charges ever filed with the Lori, with his ex-wife. There was only the letters they mutually exchanged when they were going through their divorce.
Yes.
Wow.
No. Number two against Marie.
Mm-hmm.
While I cringe at the age difference and the family connection, it's not blood, of course, but it's still, you know, that's a face palm and, you know, ear slap. What the hell are you doing? Don't do that. It's still, that's a face palm. But number three, I really have an issue here. Remember how inappropriate Wiegert and Fassbinder were with her, Doc, everyone?
It's some of the most shameful thing I've ever heard, actually.
Terrible.
And number two, this prior acts of sexual misconduct with MA, that's all hearsay as well. There was never any proof of an actual sexual relationship.
And it was investigated long before any... Yeah, well, long before anything with Teresa Hollow.
Mm-hmm. And, yeah, wow. And what is this prior sexual history? Because the first 50,000 times they tried to get her to say he did something sexual, or what? How should I say that? Something inappropriately sexually with Jody, she said he was like a vanilla cookie in bed. You know what I mean? Straight sex.
Yes.
Like what we all imagine, or I guess we're all supposed to imagine sex is, right?
And correct.
They made her expound greatly and conflated into something more than that.
Correct. 100% yeah. Correct. Alice.
What does that have to do with this case? What does their prior sexual private relationship have to do with this frigging case? You know what I mean? It is just...
You know what it's called?
What?
Neverly.
Yeah, vilification. They're vilifying Stephen. He's a monster. He's done this before. He did it again.
And piling on. This is pile on.
Yeah. And what did Judge Willis say at the end? He said that your criminal activity has become, what did he say exactly, Dr. Silkman?
Increased
while Stephen was in prison for 18 years.
Correct. I think Judge Willis actually forgot that Stephen did not sexually assault Penny Bernstein. And he said to Stephen that you're the most dangerous person in the courtroom and that your crimes have been escalating, right?
How in
the hell can his crimes be escalating if he had been in prison for 18 years, guys? Alice?
Can you imagine, though, Doc, if they did interview Jodie, right, and she was like, oh, aye, he's a fanatic in bed. He likes to tie me up. We like a wee spanking session now and again. Everything like that. Can you imagine if they let that in there? You know, but she didn't. She said that he was quite shy in bed, if you want to put it that way. He wasn't very adventurous. They had a set of handcuffs. In a sense, who doesn't have a set of handcuffs in their bedroom for a wee bit of kinky sex?
You've set off everyone in chat. But the thing is, Alice, it's no one's business, right?
Exactly.
As long as you have a consenting partner and you're not hurting your partner, then what someone does in the privacy of their own bedroom is their own business. And it's very, very concerning. And Jack 61 hit the nail on the head. The salacious questions that were being asked by Fassbender and Wiegert, which were entirely inappropriate to ask a fiancé, right? Oh, you know, Stephen and I had sex 5 times a day. So basically, you know what Mr. Kratz was trying to drive at, that Stephen Avery was a sex maniac. The only problem was it was Jodie that wanted to do different things in the privacy of their own bedroom, not Stephen. Stephen had been locked up for 18 years, right? A whole lifetime had passed him. And to me, guys, if I could just quickly summarize, because I know that Neverly has to leave, this goes to show how weak the case against Stephen actually was, right, guys? The mere fact that, check it out, prior acts, prior history, right? And the most disingenuous thing is that Mr. Kratz wanted to introduce this in a court of law, but what did he tell everyone, the judge and the jury? Right, Jack 61, right in his opening speech, he said, everything that happened from 1985 to his exoneration has got nothing to do with this case. Right, guys?
That's right.
And yet, have a look at what Mr. Kratz wants to introduce in trial to, as Neverly said, to vilify Stephen, to make him look like trash, is to bring up all these past events. Now, mind you, Stephen paid a price for some of these things that he did and ended up in prison. He served his time, right? He served his sentence. And to me, guys, it's dangerous because it demonstrates to me that Mr. Kratz's case against Stephen was extremely weak. Check 61.
Yeah, remember how frustrated it was the second September in 2006 interview that Fassbender and Wiegert that started talking about their sex life and about being tied up, blah, blah, blah. And of course, they really thought they were onto something. And then Jodie said, but I could get my hands out. I could pull my hands out.
Correct.
You know how badly that frustrated them.
And also, she said that she wanted to have as frequent sex as Stephen did. So it wasn't like he was all over her and she couldn't get away from him.
She was a willing
participant, and more power to them.
You know, 100% correct. But like I said, at the end of the day, your sexual history with your partner is your own business. If your partner consents, you're not causing any harm, psychological damage, etc., etc., what you do is your own private business.
And maybe he was jealous.
The mere fact that Kratz has admitted that he's addicted to sex, he should have been nowhere near this crime. Right, guys? He should not have been anywhere this crime. Right? Because what Mr. Kratz is trying to do is to turn it into a sex crime. Right?
With no evidence.
With no evidence, with no evidence. And yet, when there is evidence on the DASI computer, no one wants to talk about it. Right, guys? Yes. So
and
it seems to me. Correct. So it seems to me that it's only a sex crime if it involves Stephen and nobody else. Right? Okay, guys, if we don't have any more comments,
Jack 61. I just want to. I just have one. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Travis in chat. Hi, Travis. He says, I just can't agree you can take that much from the bad acts. They are offered in nearly every murder case all across the US. It's what prosecutors do. Defense lawyers offer same on the victim.
I'm actually glad he's there because I was going to ask Sheree as well. I'm curious, how much paperwork does this... So the state filing this and Buting and Strang having to prepare briefs and argue to get these dismissed, this eats up a lot of their time, right? Time they could be devoted to, they could be spending on trying to find out who actually was the perpetrator since they were, you know, defending an innocent man. But instead, they have to litigate this. They have to write these briefs. And I think the response brief for this one was a couple of hundred pages. I feel like a lot of this was intentional to eat up their time.
To muddy the waters,
Correct. And Sunshine Christina, Mr. Kratz actually had to put in separate motions in play. For all of those acts, he had to put in separate motions that the judge had to rule upon. So it's not that he presented one document. He presented separate documents. And there was a huge amount of legal material citing other cases. So it would have taken a huge amount of time by the prosecuting team to put all that together. Only for Judge Willis to say, sorry, guys, you're not admitting this. Sorry. And he sealed it.
Yeah. But they have tons of people on the payroll. The fact that Buting and Strang had to mount a defense against all these attempts, right? So that Willis had no choice but to deny it. Because I think that's how a lot of this works. They present the argument and the defense has to present proof of why none of, like most of this can't be admitted. Because what ended up being admitted? The only things that were admitted were the things he was convicted of, right?
Correct. And remember, they had to drop several of the charges with the amended criminal complaint because they weren't presenting Brendan Dassey as part of Stephen Avery's trial. So they had to drop, I think, three of the charges. And so basically, they made it, the state made it much more complex than what it was and what it had need to be. Remember what Strang told the family? Strang told and Buting told the Avery family, all you need to be done is guilty on one charge, homicide, and that's it. You're going to prison for life, right? But Mr. Kratz wanted to go much, much further than that. It was an obsession by Mr. Kratz, who left no stone unturned. And yet, this is remarkable, he didn't want anyone to bring up Stephen Avery's exoneration for the sexual assault on Penny Bernstein. You know why? Because he didn't want anyone to give him sympathy.
Well,
so on the one hand, on the one hand, he was happy to destroy Stephen, but he didn't want to present anyone to present anything to support Stephen and put him in a good light. Sunshine Christine.
They had to paint Stephen as a piece of crap, raper, child molesting, evil
monster to keep
people focused on Stephen Avery. Because in the background, what do we have? We have Stephen being exonerated from a crime that Gregory Allen committed, and there is that case that's open that they don't know about, that Gregory Allen had been linked to by DNA, that if the media had ever chose to follow that lead, that would have flipped this case on its head. So they had to make Stephen what everyone focused on. They didn't want anyone talking about Penny. They didn't want anyone talking about Gregory Allen. They didn't want anybody talking about anything but what a piece of shit Stephen Avery was. That kept them focused where they needed them at.
But that's in their playbook. That's how they do it.
Correct.
You know
and
what I mean?
I wanna, yes, and I also want to thank Travis for his wisdom and information in chat. And like I said, I don't think, well, I know that I don't recall is in the legal profession, but the majority of us are not. And it's great to get that feedback from Travis. And yeah, please keep it coming. We're learning all the time. Well, look, guys, can we go back to page 18 unless anyone's got any additional comments on that matter? So this is what Mr. Kratz wanted to present in court. However, Judge Willis decided to seal it. Now, after the trial was finished, Mr. Kratz used it in press conferences and in his book. Anneveli, would you like to continue reading?
Of course. To be sure, the First Amendment protects Kratz's freedom to publish and talk about his book. But as an attorney and former lead prosecutor in the Avery and Dassey cases, Kratz's free speech rights are contained by ethical rules. Although Judge Willis unsealed the motion after Avery was convicted, the publishing of this information was unnecessary and would certainly be prejudicial to future jurors if Avery was successful in seeking a new trial. Kratz's book is an inaccurate and inflammatory attack on the popular Netflix series Making a Murderer.
Now that, guys, is absolutely crucial, right? Right, Jack 61? Kratz was still having a go at Stephen, at Brandon, their families, the film producers, and true crimers like us. Right, Jack 61?
Yeah, I think it's like he was so jealous of the whole process that they went through and how hard they worked. Remember the terrible documentary that him and Grease Buck did in 2014? I think it was called Did He Do It or something like that. It was terrible. It was terrible. And, you know, we can call Making a Murderer somewhat biased, I guess. It's just a point of view. Because the state didn't participate. And I don't mean because they didn't show certain things. I mean because the state didn't participate and represent themselves. But this other documentary that they did, oh, my God, it's awful. It is absolutely terrible. So I think he's jealous of how hard they worked and what they presented and how shady of a lot that put all of them in.
Correct, correct. And it'll be very interesting if Convicting a Murderer ever comes out. Let me tell you right now, it'll be analyzed from first frame to the last frame. in fact, in even greater scrutiny than Making a Murderer has. Right, Jack 61? And I'm sure all of us on the panel will be doing another series on Convicting a Murderer. Right, guys?
Now with more experience and knowledge.
Absolutely.
Correct. 100% correct.
But the audacity to call it, did he do it after the trial?
Correct.
Did he do it? You know, that's like equivalent to OJ, if I did it.
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah. That's just think of the irony. Yeah.
Yeah, if I could just read out what Graham Moss said, I totally agree with him. He says, Dr. Silkman, KK wanted Stephen to be one of the worst criminal in USA. He wanted to make loads of money writing books. There's no question. He was profiteering from the murder of Teresa Halbach. And Mr. Kratz thought he was a good guy by trying to destroy Stephen Avery all over again. Now, Stephen Avery has been convicted and charged. He's in prison. He's not walking the streets of Los Angeles or in Hollywood or whatever. He's doing hard time in a prison cell. And he's been there since 2005. Yet, Mr. Kratz is not satisfied with that. He still wants to go after Stephen, and in the most harshest, cruelest manner. And let me tell you, what we've got coming up in this podcast, you will not believe what Mr. Kratz tried to do with Stephen. Neville, would you like to continue our reading, please?
Yes, the worse of a villain Stephen is, the bigger the hero Kratz would be. So he was going after that.
He wanted to destroy Stephen. Stephen was a dangerous man because he was the poster child for the Innocence Project, right? Now, we know the purpose of the Innocence Project, right, guys, is to get people out of prison who have been wrongfully convicted. When a prisoner walks free and is exonerated, it means that the entire legal system, from judge to jury to prosecuting attorneys to the forensic crime lab, have made mistakes, right? Have made mistakes. And in some states, they pay dearly for it in millions of dollars in compensation. Now, if you're a prosecuting attorney, do you like the presence of the Innocence Project? Yes or no? Jack 61.
No. Oh, no, hell no. If you're a prosecuting attorney, no way.
Correct. So what do? You attack the poster child of the Innocence Project, right?
You make him a monster.
You make him a monster. And then you make the Innocence Project feel guilty that they exonerated Stephen. And remember what the Herman and others had said? Well, had Stephen still been in prison, maybe Teresa Horbach would have been alive. So now law enforcement are acting like Nostradamus. So they're saying that it was better for an innocent man to die in prison rather than be released and potentially cause another crime, right? And Mr. Kratz said the same thing about Brendan. Remember, guys? Remember what he said about Brendan? Oh, when Judge Duffin ruled, he goes, oh, Brendan, we're going to wait for MAM 3, right? When the crew come down again saying, oh, Brendan Dassey raped and murdered another victim.
Yep.
Right? So he could not, he could not let it go. Neville, would you like to continue?
Yes.
Yes.
If Stephen was a garden variety of a criminal, Kratz wouldn't get his golden cape. So you see that it's a symbiotic relationship in Kratz's stupid head, or clever, or deviant, not stupid, deviant head. He had to do that so he would be a bigger, better, grandiose hero. But I will continue.
100% correct. Thank you, Neville.
From Gershman's perspective, there appears to be no legitimate reason for Kratz to disseminate this inflammatory information. Although the Avery and Dassey cases have attracted widespread interest, and were subject of a 10-part Netflix series, Making a Murderer, Kratz was in a unique position that was different from all other journalists and commentators. Kratz was the lead prosecutor against Avery and Dassey. Kratz was privy to considerable confidential information that had not been officially revealed. Ethical standards specifically address the question of the extent to which a former prosecutor is allowed to reveal secret information obtained in confidence while investigating and prosecuting a criminal matter.
All right. Now, if we can have a look at the next slide. As you know, guys, Mr. Kratz wrote a book in 2017. And this was a result of MAM 1. And of course, he got Nancy Disgrace to write the foreword of the book. And I'll tell you what, after MAM 2 came out, he had to write a second edition. And that book was released in October 2019. So basically, he amended his book to include a new chapter, basically trying to counteract Kathleen Zoner. And to show how much he respected Kathleen Zoner, he called that chapter When the Circus Comes to Town.
Yeah.
Right? So here is, this goes to show, first of all, look at the difference between both editions of that book. In the first edition, he has Stephen Avery in the top right-hand corner, peering, looking at you.
Burnt pages.
And in the second edition, he's got Stephen in full view, right? And that's deliberate. And have a look at the way Stephen is dressed, right? Like the Monopoly man, black and white, and he's wearing gloves. He's probably got a stun belt on as well.
Right? They were going to do that.
Yes, they're going to put a stun belt on him.
His defense team stopped it.
They're going to put a stun belt on him. Correct.
As far as I understand, every defendant has a right to wear civilian clothing. So what they did to him, this was parading him around like really like a clown, like Hannibal Lecter.
Hannibal Lecter, correct. They did parade him like Hannibal Lecter. And what is incredible here is that one of our panel members, Susan, by the way, went through both editions, the first and second edition. And Susan worked out all the changes that Ken Kratz made from the first to the second edition. He edited stuff in and edited stuff out, right? Now, we haven't done that podcast yet where we compared both editions, but I've prepared all the slides. I just need to get some time and do it because this is truly shocking. One of the accusations that Mr. Kratz made against Netflix, the producers of Netflix, is that they edited transcripts during the trial. Mr. Kratz did exactly the same thing in his books. Does anyone want to make a comment? Anyone want to make a comment on that?
Well, one of the first ones we know he made was about we were coming in and that morning saying that I can't remember the wording now, but he changed it. Guess what happened this morning?
Yeah, Wiegert said, you're not going to believe the last stop that that Teresa Horbach was at. And that was November the 3rd.
That's right.
November the 3rd. And so I tell you what, the only important thing in that whole book was the conversation with Wiegert and Kratz. And it goes to show that they already had Stephen Avery's name on their lips on November the 3rd, right, guys, without a scintilla of forensic evidence. Nothing. They already associated Stephen, who had the $36 million civil lawsuit, with Teresa Horbach on November the 3rd. That's 2 days before the RAV4 was found. Jack 61.
Yeah, just one more brief comment before Neverly starts reading again is when in 2016, at some point relatively early, Kratz went to the DOJ and tried to get access to his old case file and the old laptop because they gave him a laptop computer to keep the Avery and Dassey cases on, and he wanted access to that. He said, I'll just bring everything with me. You don't have to worry about anything. You just let me have the material. And they wouldn't do it. We think that they wouldn't do it, and I don't blame them. Because that stuff has to be locked away. And he was no longer a prosecutor, so he can't just have automatic access to it. But he tried.
Correct. 100% correct.
Makes you wonder what he wanted.
Yes, it does. You do wonder what really was on that computer. And Neverly, did you have a quick comment?
No, I'm sorry. I just coughed. I'm sorry. That was rude.
No worries. Alice, do you have a comment?
Just a wee bit of advice to people out there who are maybe thinking about buying this crap. Don't. Or if you do, the only thing it's good for is teaching your arse to read, because that's the only thing decent thing you could do with it, is to teach your butt to read, because it's no worth anything else.
Well, thank you, Alice. Sunshine and Christina, do you have a quick comment?
That's actually a better use than what I thought you were going to say, because I thought you were going to say it's good to wipe your butt with. So.
Well,
Well, that's basically it, Christina. I mean, back in the day, when my dad used to, like, if we ran out of newspaper or whatever, out of toilet paper or whatever, my dad used to grab a newspaper. And I'm like, what are you doing with that, Dad? He's like, I'm going to teach my Ash to read. So he was going to wipe his bum with the newspaper. So that's the only thing that these two books are good for. Not even that, is to teach your Ash to read.
Well, a lot of YouTubers have made comment on Mr. Kratz's book. I dare say that very few have actually read Mr. Kratz's book from cover to cover. Now, if we have a look at the next slide. Now, I actually thought it would have been a good project for the Foul Play team to go over Mr. Kratz's book, right? Do a review. Boy, did we do it, a review. We actually did 63 podcasts on Ken Kratz's book. We went through it from cover to cover, every chapter, and in great detail. So, guys, if you haven't checked out on our YouTube channel, I really urge you to have a listen to some of those podcasts. And last night, I listened to our very first one on the series Reading with Uncle Ken, and it's a classic. I couldn't stop laughing for multiple reasons. And we also had Bibi on the program, and we had Susan, Jack61, I think Just Rhonda was there as well, Neverly. But there was one person in the chat who kept on, oh, Kratz is a bleep bleep, and this book is a bleep bleep. And it came from a person called Alice. Now, Alice, that wasn't you by any chance before you joined the Foul Play team. Was that you in chat giving your 2 cents worth of wisdom on the book? There was an Alice in the chat absolutely hammering on the book. That wasn't you, was it, Alice?
I could say I'm taking the fifth.
You're taking the fifth.
In the words of Cherie, yep. I don't recall.
I don't recall. Awesome. Now, the Foul Play team, our panel, spent 140 hours on Mr. Kratz's book. And I reckon that we spent 139 more than what we should have. But I tell you what, no one has analyzed Mr. Kratz's book, the second edition, greater than what we did. And it was very important to do so because we really got an understanding of Mr. Kratz, his thinking, and why he wrote the book. And I'll tell you what, if you ever get a chance, have a look at the Reading with Uncle Ken series. You're not going to find anything better than that anywhere on the internet. I reckon we know the book better than Mr. Kratz. Right, Jack61?
Absolutely. And the number of embedded confessions that are scattered throughout that book are, yes, mind-blowing.
Absolutely huge, the amount of embedded confessions that are in that series. So please check it out. Now, look, guys, having spent 63 podcasts on one book, Jack61, and you had to put the next slide up by the 63rd podcast, I'm sure that everyone on the panel was feeling like hit like this guy. We were homicidal, suicidal. We had had enough, right?
Here's Johnny.
But I tell you what, I'm so, so proud of that series. I'm so proud of the panel and the team. And every time Susan spoke in Mr. Kratz's voice, it just sent a shiver down everyone's spine. Right, Susan? Do you have a comment? Oh, no, I think your microphone's muted.
Hey, Sugar.
Oh, hey, there.
Yes, we can.
There she is.
Awesome.
And she still didn't die.
That's correct. That's correct. So, guys, I'm telling you, If you ever want a very, very comprehensive series and an analysis on a book, check out our Reading with Uncle Ken series. There's a huge amount of material that we covered. I'm so, so proud of that. All right. Now, Neville, would you like to continue reading, please? We're sure. On page 19E.
E. But even more appalling behavior by Kratz began in 2013, after he had already been forced to resign from office in shame and disgrace. By that point, he had retreated for far northwestern Wisconsin, where he was struggling to make it private practice as a criminal defense attorney in Superior, Wisconsin. Kratz's correspondence to Avery included outlandish requests pressuring Avery to add him to his prisoner list of visitors.
Can you believe this? Can you believe
shameless, that? Shameless, shameless. No scruples, no morals, no ethics, no boundaries, nothing. Kratz further badgers Avery in his correspondence of September 6, 2015. Quote, since I'm the person who probably knows more about your case than anyone else, I hoped that you would choose me to tell your story to. Unfortunately, you only want to continue your nonsense about being set up. That's too bad, because you had one opportunity to finally tell the details, but now that will never happen. Blech.
And don't worry, we've actually got the correspondence that we're going to read out on this channel. So let's set the stage. Right? You successfully prosecute both Stephen and Brendan for the murder of Teresa Horbach. You send them both to prison for life. Then Mr. Kratz has the gall to personally write to Stephen to get a confession of what actually happened to Teresa Horbach, because the state's got no idea. And for Stephen to come clean, so wait for it, Mr. Kratz can write a book and profit from the proceeds of his book. So Mr. Kratz is basically asking the very person he sent to prison for life to confess and come clean. Jack 61.
Yeah, and he has the gall. You think about, you know, also on that stage, let's move back to 2008 and 9 when he's doing all this really shady crap. And then he gets caught. This SBG turns him in. He gets buried for almost a year. Ryan Foley from the AP somehow finds out and he requests those documents and he exposes it. He gets up, Kratz gets his ass thrown out of office, or he's going to get fired. He knows that. And so he, you know, in 2010, October, you know, he skulks away, or September, whenever the hell it was, of 2010, he skulks away. And now he comes back and he's trying to approach Stephen to write a book to make money on this case. It's unreal.
He just can't let go.
He cannot, Neville, you nailed it. He cannot let it go. Not only did he want to bring all those past acts into the trial, he now is pursuing the very same person he put into prison for life. Now, if you're Stephen Avery, how do you think you feel when the prosecutor is now wanting you to confess, come clean, tell the story about what happened so Mr. Kratz can write a book and profit from Teresa?
But the way he did it, so condescending, so disrespectful, so just, oh my gosh, I really want to vomit.
Correct. And
but
don't
that's
worry,
too we'll bad.
We're going to read out
had
the
one
emails.
Opportunity. Yeah.
We'll read them out. Jack 61, do you have a comment?
Well, yeah. I mean, I know if you know, even if I was guilty of something, I know what I'd tell him. I'd tell him to fuck off.
Correct. And we'll talk about it. What Stephen did absolutely shocked Mr. Kratz. And Neville, would you like to continue, please?
Sure. Gershman maintains that in all of his years of practicing law and studying the ethics and misconduct of prosecutors, He has never once witnessed someone like rats.
And that,
quote,
that in itself is an incredible admission for someone like Gershman, who's been in the system for a long period of time, to say something like that about Mr. Kratz, that he's so unique, he has never encountered a scumbag like that. That says a lot.
Mr. Gershman, he practices in New York, which is like the center of the world, capitalism at its best. So you can only imagine all these huge companies, what they're doing. And he was not only consulting, but he was also teaching, educating these future judges, present judges, attorneys.
Correct.
Those are his colleagues. Not to put Wisconsin down, but you can't really compare Wisconsin and New York. You just can't. So imagine the shock and the seething when he was reading about Kratz.
100% correct. And this is someone who has seen it all, right? He has dealt with the worst of the worst. And for him to say that he has never encountered someone like Kratz is amazing. Susan, did you have a comment? I'm not sure whether Susan, do you have a comment? Okay.
No,
okay.
I don't.
All right. Neville, would you like to continue reading?
Kratz's conduct in approaching the man he vilified brought unsubstantiated charges against, convicted of murder, and sent to prison for life without parole in order to tell his story, quote unquote, is unlike any conduct of any ex-prosecutor I have ever encountered, Gershman said. Wow. Kratz's conduct is offensive to the proper administration of justice. His intimidation and manipulation of his own selfish motive of the person he prosecuted impairs the dignity of the legal profession and the ethical responsibility of lawyers to abstain from overreaching, harassing, and manipulative conduct. Boom.
All right. Now, we've actually got the emails that he sent to Stephen, right? Now, there's no question about it because I checked the dates. Mr. Kratz wrote to Stephen first. Now, I know that Just Rhonda has got something. Just Rhonda, can you see that email? It's
yes.
Slide 20B. Are you able to read out 20B, please?
Yes.
Thank you.
Close my door really quick.
Now, I'm telling you, if this occurred in Australia, all hell would break loose. This would make front page news everywhere that an attorney, an ex-attorney, is approaching the very person he put into prison for life. Just Rhonda.
Yep, I'm ready. Okay. So this is to Stephen from what's his name? And it's regarding a request for a meeting. Dear Mr. Avery, as you know, I was formerly the district attorney of Calumet County and served as lead prosecutor in your criminal case between 2005 and 2007. I no longer am an elected DA, and in fact, I'm not affiliated with the state of Wisconsin in any way. I am in private law practice. I have determined that your criminal appeal process is concluded, and therefore, you are not currently represented by counsel. If I'm mistaken, please disregard this correspondence. I'm also aware that there is no present civil case where you and I are parties to the action, and I do not believe there's any further prohibition in my contacting you or in you agreeing to speak with me. I would like to meet with you personally at your facility to discuss your case. It is for my own personal use and not in connection with any state action or investigation. You will be given nothing of value if you agree to meet with me, other than having the chance to talk to me directly and ask any questions you may wish. I will be honest with you in our meeting and obviously have questions I would like to ask you. If you agree, please write to me at my law firm and tell me how I can secure a visit with you. If you are not interested, either throw this letter away or write to me telling me that you are not interested. It's obviously all up to you. Sincerely yours, Ken Kratz.
Now, can we open it up for comments, please? Who would like to make a comment?
Well, where do we begin, Dr. Stelkman?
That's exactly correct.
He's just the most narcissistic piece of shit. He's just... It's disgusting. First, to introduce himself, in case you weren't aware, I'm the dickhole who prosecuted you, and I would really like to speak to you and ask you questions. And I would like for you to ask me any questions you may wish. He's such a piece of dirt.
As if Steven can ever forget who he is.
Right. Such an idiot.
Same, correct. 100% correct. Susan, did you have a comment?
Yeah. The entire story at the trial, I'm curious what questions he had for Steven.
He probably wanted to know what actually happened to Teresa Horbach, because it's pretty obvious that if the state knew what had happened, they wouldn't be talking to Steven, correct? And if the state doesn't know what happened, doesn't that tell you that they don't believe Brendan Dassey? They don't believe that what Brendan Dassey told them was in actual fact the truth. Brendan Dassey was coerced.
They knew that.
Yeah, 100% correct. That they had to have known that what Brendan said to them was just garbage. Now, for them, for Stephen Avery to be contacted by the very person that put him in prison, say, I've got some questions to ask you, to me, that's shocking. Are you trying to tell me that in 6 weeks and for however time you had to prepare your case, you're now asking questions of the person you sentenced to life in prison? I've never seen anything like this, guys. Sunshine Christina.
So, couple of things. One, I wonder how long Kratz spent trying to pen this letter, because this is obviously his attempt to have the including interview with convicted killer Stephen Avery on the title of his book. Right? He was either pushed to do it, or he thought, wow, that would be an interesting headline on his book cover. Two, I wonder what Stephen was thinking when he was reading this for the first time, knowing I'm innocent, knowing this guy knows I'm innocent, yet he has the balls to write me?
That's huge. Like,
yeah, like I can't imagine what went through Stephen's brain reading this letter. Like, because if I got a letter from a guy who knowingly put me in prison for a crime I didn't commit, I would, like, lose my shit, right? I would be so mad at the audacity that this guy has and my inability to do anything but not throw it away, right? Because it's proof that these guys are still tormenting me, even though I'm correct. In prison. Yeah, it's just such correct. It's such a sadistic thing to do.
Sadistic.
It's very sadistic.
No ethics whatsoever. So let me just say quickly before I get Jack 61 on the line, Stephen did respond to Mr. Kratz in June 2013. Now, we don't have the copy of his correspondence. It was handwritten. But essentially, you know what he said to Mr. Kratz? He goes, oh, what? Well, in that case, why don't you represent me and get me out of prison? Right, Jack 61.
Yep.
He goes, we can write a book and both make money.
Yep.
So he turned the tables on Mr. Kratz to say, well, if you're free, Why don't you represent me and get me out of prison? Jack 61.
Yeah, I was going to say, I zoomed out in on that date on this letter, and it's January of 2013. I'd have to pull it up. I'm pretty sure that Avery wrote his pro se motion in 2013. It wasn't that early, but it was a little bit later. I'd have to pull it up to find out what the actual date, but I know it was in that time frame. So his, because Kratz went in his detail there, said that I've determined your appeals are done. You're finished. Which was not true at all.
So, yes.
Yeah. I'm just wondering where he pulled that out of.
Yeah, I just want to make the comment. I understand what Travis is saying. I really do. That there's nothing preventing Mr. Kratz approaching Stephen. But I'm just saying morally and ethically, should you? That's what I'm questioning. I know Vince Bugliosi interviewed and wrote a book, Helter Skelter. Interviewing Charles Manson, et cetera, et cetera. But I think this is very, very different, right? This is very, very different. If you prosecuted Stephen and Brendan successfully, what the hell are you contacting Stephen for asking, oh, can you tell me the true story? Yes, who? Who said that?
Me, Neverly.
Neverly.
Who's to say that Kratz wouldn't ask some salacious questions to Stephen? As sick as it sounds, I wouldn't put past him. Who's to say that he wouldn't say something, did you get aroused? How did it feel?
No. That I agree, because that's exactly what Tom Fassbender, remember what he wrote in his book, guys? That on the day that Teresa Horbach, I think it was October something, the 10th, I think, they found a photograph of Stephen Avery's erect penis. And Tom Fassbender said, well, looks like Stephen got an appropriate reaction to Teresa Horbach's visit. Right? So I have no hesitation. That's exactly what Mr. Kratz wanted to find out. Right?
For his own personal pleasure.
Yeah, and I'm sure it would have headed in that direction. Sunshine Christina, do you have a comment?
I was just going to say, he's like a moth to the flames. That's exactly what he is. Even though there's nothing legally preventing him from contacting Stephen Avery, he was broke and he wanted to have one more bite at Stephen Avery's apple to try and milk him for some more money. You know, it's probably Ken Kratz's biggest payday was framing him and Brendan. And so what do you do when you're broke? You go back to that which makes you the most money the quickest.
Correct. But Mr. Kratz could not repair the damage to his reputation. He destroyed himself. But approach Stephen. And remember, Stephen spent an additional 12 years in prison for something he never did, right? And then for Mr. Kratz to have the gall to say, we don't want to present this in court, you're not going to talk about it. And then to approach Stephen, who potentially could be innocent. How would you feel, Jack 61?
Well, you know, I think that, you know, understanding where Travis is coming from, and I get it. Yeah, there's nothing...
Yes.
I guess on the face of it, wrong with Kratz approaching him to want to get this in some kind of book. But I think, you know, from our standpoint, because we have such a dig for Kratz because he's just the way he is and the things he did. To me, it's ethically and maybe even somewhat morally, it's like, what the hell are you doing, man? Because
an innocent man.
But him knowing, I feel certain that he knows that there were certain things that were done that were highly inappropriate that, you know, they got away with. I'm not saying that it didn't happen in trial. I'm just saying they got away with it, with all the things that they kept away from the jury, the things that they tried to sell, or they did sell to the public to turn the tide of the public against Stephen and Brendan. I guess, you know, I have to take all that into account. And then for him to approach him and say, hey, man, you can talk to me. Let's, get this out in a book, you know. Now, you're not going to get anything for it. Not going to get anything.
Correct.
But I will. I don't know. It just comes off terrible, Doc.
Correct. Now, remember, Stephen Avery never admitted to doing anything nefarious to Teresa Halbach, ever. So,
he never wavered,
Never wavered. Still today has not wavered, right? And it's very interesting that, to me, and we discussed it last week, the truth has not been revealed. We don't know what the truth is. And this is quite a shock, and by truth, I mean what actually happened to Teresa Halbach. This is quite shocking that now Mr. Kratz is using the backdoor approach to somehow find that truth. That his investigators and his crime lab and all the freaking 14 or 16 experts were not able to uncover the truth. To me, that demonstrates the character of the man, the desperation of the man, that he has to now approach Stephen, who's been incarcerated in prison, and if he doesn't get out, will die in prison. To me, it ethically and morally is so shocking, right? Now, are we able to go to page 20C? So this is another correspondence that Kratz wrote to Stephen. I don't recall. Can you see that page? This is page 20C. I'll just wait.
Yes.
Can you? You happy to read? Are you happy to read it out?
Yes, I can.
All right, let's go for it, guys.
Dear Mr. Avery, please recall that in the spring of 2013, you had requested that I come visit you at the Wisconsin State Program facility in Boscobel, Wisconsin. You neglected to add me to your visitor list, and after we had arranged a visit, the prison canceled the visit, stating that the visit would be contrary to your programming there. They didn't want me talking to you. Now that you have been transferred to Waupun Correctional Institution and we are not dealing with the same staff or program problems, I'm writing to inquire whether you still want me to come visit you. If you do, please write to me and add me to your visitors list. I had indicated previously that the Department of Corrections probably does not want you to tell your story to me, but it is my belief that they can't tell you who you can tell your story to. And that is your decision, if you want to talk to me or not. You no longer have any pending litigation, including appeals, and therefore there is no conflict which exists to you speaking with me. I'm willing to visit with you if you want me to.
Now, mind you, like nearly 2 years have gone by, and he has another crack at Stephen. Does anyone have a quick comment?
Yes.
Yes, Nadine.
With Chuck, we all have already determined he is a self-proclaimed narcissist. He was diagnosed, and he went to rehab, and blah, blah, all of that. That he is very smart, that he is very clever, twisted, demented, sadistic. All of that. But you know what? As I mentioned before, he is self-destructive. This is
correct.
This is one way of self-destruction. He is just like gnawing and gnawing and gnawing and gnawing at it, and he will never let it go. 2 years later, he's still going at it.
He's still
that's not normal behavior. That's not normal behavior. And it's one thing to write a book about Charles Manson, Ted Bundy, go interview him, all the other ones. However, Stephen and the prosecution very well knows that Stephen was innocent and that they pulled some magic tricks to convict him. And that's why this is so wrong, because he is innocent. And the same man who prosecuted him, said all those horrible things about him, made him suffer, and finally he put him in prison for the rest of his life without a possibility of parole. He's contacting him for selfish reasons. That's not normal behavior.
No,
even though
not.
Nothing is preventing him, By law, ethically and morally, he's a piece of shit.
But I agree, Neville. But you know what I think was on the back of his mind? His level of desperation, knowing full well that potentially there was going to be a Making a Murderer series coming out. Right? And so in the back of his mind, he's thinking, wow, how about if I get that jump on the producers and act on Stephen before Making a Murderer comes out and exposes all the shenanigans? It's only a theory, and I'm speculating, but it's interesting that Kratz did not let it go. Susan?
I thought the same thing, Doug. Yeah, it's right. Wow. Before Ma'am, and they let them know earlier.
Yep.
Then
isn't that incredible?
Came out that it was coming out, so yeah.
Yep, isn't that incredible? Thank you, Susan. Alice, do you have a comment?
Yeah, this is just Kratz all over. I mean, how many other prosecutors do you know that have a big case like Stevens was and is, because he was an exoneree, and then he's now getting charged with a murder and that 2 years later? The guy who puts him away should know what his case was about. So why is he having to get in touch with Stephen to ask Stephen more questions? He should know all the answers because he put Stephen away. So he should know all
the answers. He doesn't know.
In the case.
He doesn't know the answers, Alice. He doesn't know the answers.
No, but back then he's saying that he did, and that's why he put Stephen away. You know, in my opinion, this was him trying to get interviews with Stephen so that he could record the interviews or whatever, or take notes, and then twist every single word that Stephen said to
and fuck him again. Yes.
Yes. Correct. Exactly. That is the only reason why. And yeah, you have a good point. It might have been because he knew that Making a Murderer was coming up, and he knows what happened through the case, and he knows that how bad it makes him look. So in my opinion, this was him trying to get to Stephen to get more info for his book to go against Making a Murderer, so that when Making a Murderer came out and all this about Stephen and about the prosecution and everything like that, then he could come out and say, oh no, well, I've interviewed Stephen on and this is what Stephen said. So Making a Murderer has got this wrong and that wrong. But he done that anyway without speaking to Stephen. You know what I mean? So it was all for himself, Doc. It wasn't for Stephen's benefit. It wasn't to help Stephen. And does he honestly think that Stephen wanted anything to friggin' do with him at that point?
Yep, 100% correct. Thank you, Alice. Jack61, what have you got on the screen? You want to discuss that for a second?
Just for a second, because I was pretty sure I was right. Look at the date. This is Avery's pro se motion. February 14th, 2013. It's almost like, I'm not saying this is true, this is speculation. That first letter was dated January, and it's almost like that Kratz knew that Avery was working on this pro se motion somehow. He knew, because somebody clearly helped Stephen write this, but I had never really thought about it before, but I wanted to show this date.
yes. When you got to look at the chronology of when events took place. Mr. Kratz doesn't do anything in a vacuum. He always has a reason why he does things.
That's right.
And you know, it's very interesting that it was Mr. Kratz that kept on pursuing Stephen. It wasn't Tom Fallon. It wasn't Norm Garn. It was Mr. Kratz. He could not eat, and as others have mentioned, like a moth to a flame. It was just truly remarkable. I don't recall, did you have a comment?
I just wondered, the only book that I've read that a prosecutor wrote about somebody that he prosecuted was the Bugliosi or whoever there that wrote about Charles Manson. But I don't know. I don't remember that author going like asking Charles Manson if he could write his story and going, you know, he probably just wrote it, I'm assuming, about his experience and what he knew about the case. This seems different, where he's, you know, Kratz is going to him and, or trying to go to him personally. And it just, to me, it seems like he's trying to, you know, the knife is in there, let me twist it. That's what it looks like to me.
But you know what to me, what it is? It's like a priest getting a parishioner to finally confess, come to me. You could tell me anything that you want. Right here, Mr. Kratz is acting like a priest, wanting to get that final confession. So then Mr. Kratz can write a book and tell the world and say, see, I was right. But Stephen never gave him that satisfaction, right? And why should he? So if we have a look at page 20D, Susan, you got to read 20D. Can you see 20D?
I actually can't, Doc. My computer is not working well.
Not good. Shall I get somebody else to read it?
Is that the September?
September 6, 2015. Can you see it?
Okay. I can see it now. Yeah.
Now, are you able to do it in your best Mr. Kratz voice? Please.
We might
lose 20 subscribers from this, but let's do it. This is Mr. Kratz's final response to Stephen.
Regarding, I'm not interested. Dear Mr. Avery, I dated August 28, 2015, wherein you tell me that your visitor list is full. And if I checked out other fingerprints found on Teresa Halbach's car, telling people could have set you up for this, I apologize for misunderstanding your letter from a couple years ago. I thought you were interested in being honest about what happened and finally telling the whole story to someone. Since I'm the person who probably knows more about your case than anyone else, I hope that you would choose me to tell your story to. Unfortunately, you only want to continue your nonsense about being set up. That's too bad. Because you had one opportunity to finally tell all the details. But now, that will never happen. By the way, the difference between you and famous convicted murderers from the past is they told their whole truthful story. Their whole truthful story to someone who then wrote a book about what actually happened. And people got to understand both sides. I was willing to do that for you. But if you're going to continue a lie about what happened between you and Ms. Halbach, I am not interested to change your mind and tell your honor that please contact me. Can you
catch? I'm totally lost. I am totally lost. Can anyone help me out in this? Is this bad or what?
It's terrible. I mean, to me, you know, but this time, Laura and Maura are involved, right? And, you know, it's almost like he's gotten wind of them doing this documentary and continuing to, you know, expand their story and do filming and talking to people. It's like he's doing a preemptive to me, because this is probably around this is somewhere in the time frame, I think, of when did he do it, got released. I think that's right. I'd have to ask Jinx. She's the one's got the video, but it was somewhere around this time frame. But it's almost like he knows that there's going to be another side of the story gets stolen. He's trying to do a preemptive.
Yep, 100%.
You know what it sounds to me like?
Desperation.
Yes, and exactly what he was, how he was texting that lady.
Oh yeah. Like,
you know, taunting her, being so disrespectful. What, Kitty got
turning
your...
Turning the tables. Turning the tables.
Yeah, turning the tables. And, yes, and now, ultimately, in his sick mind, he can say that it was he who actually turned Stephen down, not the other way around.
Correct. Now, look.
I'm not interested.
Let's be straight. Let's be straight. Even if you felt that Stephen Avery was guilty, is this the conduct of an ex-prosecutor? Is this the proper conduct of an ex-prosecutor who put that person in prison for life to now contact that person and say, tell me your story? Just Rhonda.
Well, just before I have to take off, I just wanted to say, I remember reading this originally, and I was so disgusted and disturbed by it. And it's a, and I know this word is overused a lot, but it's a form of gaslighting, to, you know, on Stephen. And it's like, I just want to, you know, say, Mr. Kratz, do you realize that your ego and your narcissism is showing? Because he's just so, he just can't get enough of himself. And it's gross, and it's disgusting. And it's disturbing. It's truly disturbing.
Correct. Correct. And not only that, in my opinion, it's incredibly unethical. And Gershman, smoke must have been coming out of his ears when he read those emails, thinking, what the hell, Mr. Kratz? Susan, do you have a quick comment?
Yeah, I'd like to know, if even if Stephen was guilty, why has his one opportunity to tell the truth, and now it will never happen? Oh, Jesus. Yeah, talk about a narcissist.
That's correct. And what's even worse, guys, before I put Jack 61 on the line, what's even worse is that Stephen is actually trying to plead his innocence. He's actually doing the right thing. He's going through Kathleen Zellner, right, who's the queen of exoneration lawyers. And yet, what is the state doing? The state is saying, no, 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 we don't even want you in front of a judge. So Stephen is going through the right legal channels and is being denied. Yet, Mr. Kratz wanted to break all ranks and go straight to Stephen. Tell me your story. I'm going to write a book. We'll both, I'm going to profit from it and you're going to get nothing. Jack 61.
Now that I've thought about it a little bit more as far as timeline, remember the emails that we read in the Coleman v. Netflix case? And a lot of these go back to 2013, 2014, 2015. I'm just wondering, because they didn't really tell, they didn't really get into detail about who all they contacted. I'll bet you he found out that way. I'll bet money on it. And he's trying to do a preemptive and say, hey, I need to get your story. You don't need to be talking to these people. I'll get you to sign an exclusive with me. And that way you can't talk to them.
Yes.
As I recall, August.
Say that again, Susan, your guitar a little bit.
Yeah, you broke up.
As I recall, that was in August that they were contacting Lauren Moore.
Yeah. Okay. Alice, did you have a comment?
Yeah, this just exactly proves my point on what I said about the last one, Doc, about him doing it for himself, especially with that sentence. I got your letter dated August 28th, 2015, where you tell me that your visitor list is full and ask if I checked out other fingerprints found on Stephen Hallback's car, telling me that these people could have set you up for this. And then he goes on to say, you know, well, I'm not going to talk to you now. If you're going to continue insisting on being insistent, then your story's not going to get told. You know what I mean? Did he honestly think was going to happen? Did he honestly think that he was going to sit across with Stephen and Stephen was going to sit there and go, oh, yes, Mr. Crass, you were absolutely right. I did do this, and this. You know what I mean? No way was Stephen going to do that. So that proves my point even more, that if he sat down with an interview with Stephen, whatever Stephen told him, he was going to twist and rechange and everything like that to suit his own narrative so that he could put in his book, well, I spoke to Mr. Avery on such and such a day and this is what he told me. So making a murderer's telling lies. You know,
I agree with you, Alice. There was an expectation by Mr. Kratz that Stephen was going to tell all and admit his guilt. And in other words, there's no way that Mr. Kratz wanted to hear anything else but for Stephen to admit his guilt to him so he could write a book and profit from it. It's as simple as that.
That's right.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly, Doc, which is disgusting. It is absolutely disgusting that he even thought. I mean, Stephen's put in all these motions and everything like that, and then he gets the best lawyer because he's got Kathleen by then, has he not, by this September 6th?
No. He had filed his pro se motion, and it got shot down by Judge Angie. And then that was in 2013. And I don't think she answered till sometime in early 2014, I think. But he had already contacted him.
And we know Kratz read that pro se.
That's right. Absolutely.
We know he read that pro se. Stephen still, you know, what is he all of a sudden believe that Stephen's going to confess to him?
Incorrect. Exactly. Ridiculous.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Alice. Sunshine Christina, did you have a quick comment?
I just wanted to say, I wonder if Kratz's thought process was, I was going to get this interview, I was going to go in there with him and try and sell to him, you're never going to be free. If you help me write a best-selling book, I'll send you commissary. Thinking that Stephen Avery, after maintaining his innocence for all these years, Ken Kratz could talk him into telling a lie to help him sell his book. Like, I mean, did he really think he was that slick and Stephen Avery was that desperate for money?
I think so, Christina.
Yeah, I mean, because, you know, it would be one thing if Stephen Avery had ever waffled, right, had ever shown any sign of maybe taking a plea. But not only did he never do that in the Penny Bernstein case, he's never done that in this case either. And so it's clear that Stephen Avery's not motivated by anything but the truth, right? And any crime he ever committed, he admitted guilt to. He didn't try and play around with it. I did the crime. I accept the time, you know. Like the criminal justice system is supposed to work, and yet he's being played and used by people who are sworn in and elected to uphold the law, and he's being used and manipulated for their own personal gain. And it's quite sad that someone with a lower IQ and education is actually showing more morals and ethics than all these highly educated people put together.
Correct. Thank you. Thank you so much, Sunshine Christina. Just Rhonda, did you have a quick comment?
I did, but I forgot. Sorry.
Okay. Okay. Nevely, how long have you got before you have to go? You still got a bit of time?
Yeah, I still have a bit of time.
Okay. So shall we
Yeah.
continue reading at page 21?
Yeah, sure. Give me just 1 second, please.
No hassles. No hassles. All right, so I thought it was a good idea to actually show Mr. Kratz's correspondence because some people, and I think Travis and others, have already made the connection to the way Mr. Kratz wrote to Stephen to what he actually texted some of his sexual abuse victims. Very astute there, Travis. Okay, Neville, shall we continue?
Sure. In Gershman's purview, Kratz's ploy to convince Avery into believing that Kratz would be inclined to write an honest book from Avery's perspective is another falsehood that erodes at the credibility of the judicial system. Kratz's solicitation of Avery is akin to a personal injury lawyer's solicitation of cases from recent accident victims. Dubbed ambulance chasing, such conduct has seriously impaired the reputation of the bar. Kratz's conduct, in my opinion, is even more nefarious. Kratz had a personal involvement with Avery and sought to manipulate that connection under the guise of appearing to act on Avery's behalf to help him tell his honest, quote-unquote, story so that the public would understand both sides, quote-unquote. But of course, Kratz's appeal for Avery's cooperation, ostensibly for disinterested motives, was a sham. Kratz wanted to write a book and get the person he prosecuted to help him.
Yes.
His solicitation was disingenuous and prejudicial to the administration of justice. He did exactly the same to the domestic violence victims. He did the same thing.
100%, and also to the I forgot his name, to the person that interviewed him, the journalist that interviewed him. Remember when Mr. Kratz did his falsetto voice?
Ron,
and scared
Ron,
the hell out of everyone.
Ron Foley.
Foley. Yeah, he did exactly the same thing. This is Mr. Kratz's MO, how he works, how he operates, no matter who it is.
This is his character.
That's his character, correct. Keep going, Neville.
But here's why things get even more interesting. There is an uncanny parallel between Kratz's solicitation of Avery as a private lawyer and Kratz's solicitation of vulnerable women when he was a prosecutor. In 2010, Kratz was investigated by the Wisconsin Division of Criminal Investigation for sending inappropriate text and email messages to women, including victims in active domestic abuse cases Kratz was then prosecuting. There were at least 10 women who complained about Kratz's improper sexual overtures to them. The state investigation led the Wisconsin District Attorney Association to call for Kratz's resignation, for Governor James Doyle to initiate removal proceedings against Kratz, and after Kratz involuntarily resigned, for the Office of Lawyer Regulation in 2011 to bring a disciplinary complaint against Kratz, alleging several counts of professional misconduct. Afterward, Gershman notes, Kratz was suspended from practicing law in Wisconsin for 4 months.
Four months.
A slap on the wrist. In one case where Kratz was prosecuting a parental rights termination case, Kratz became lustful toward the woman involved in the case, telling her, oh God, why do I have to always read this? Telling her, I won't come in your mouth. And later informing her that he was leaving on a wild trip to Las Vegas where he could have big-boobed women serve me drinks. Kratz commented in court to a social worker that the court reporter had big, beautiful breasts. And another time he contacted a young woman almost 30 years younger than he was, inquiring if she was the kind of girl that likes secret contact with an older elected DA, the riskier, the better. You may be tall, young, hot nymph, but I am the prize, Kratz had texted her. Indeed, Kratz, the three-time divorced Wisconsin lawyer, was in a league of his own. Time after time, women found him repulsive and did not want anything to do with him. Kratz tried to defend his appalling behavior towards the women by raising incredible, inconsistent, hyper-technical, and puzzling arguments, Gershman said. His claim that he wanted to amicably resolve the disciplinary proceedings, according to Wisconsin Supreme Court, borders on the intellectually insulting.
Yeah, so essentially what he was trying to do was to blame the victims. He was trying to turn the table on the victims. Jack 61.
I just wanted to give a quick apology for the interruption in the slides. For whatever reason, the program decided it didn't want to go any further. Maybe it just didn't want that on the screen. I don't know.
Probably.
Yeah, it's like, screw you. I'm not loading it. So I had to close it and reopen it. So we're good to go. I apologize.
Oh, dear.
You know, let's not forget he was the, was he the chair of the Victim Crime Rights Board at this time? And all of these women are being preyed upon by him. And not one person, including, I think, suck at this, the judge, was on the board at this time, by this time. No one wanted to have a actual victim of crimes rights board that had people who actually cared about the people they were caring about. It says a lot about who's running things in Wisconsin that it was only after he was exposed to the media that anyone did anything to this guy. If not, he'd still be doing these things today. With Judge Angie, the woman in charge of Stephen's freedom at this moment, sitting beside him, patting him on the back while he's taking advantage of other women. It's disgusting.
And mind you, don't forget that he lied. He said that it was lapse in judgment and he misunderstood how he should behave towards women. He thought he said that it was only one indiscretion when it turns out it was 16.
It's gaslighting.
Correct. And he had a long history. And I remember there was an interview that he did with Buting on Dr. Phil. And Buting was trying to insinuate, no, you were like this before the Stephen Avery trial, right? And Mr. Kratz was trying to say, no, it's because of the Stephen Avery trial I became addicted to drugs and sex and all this garbage. And Buting said, no, you've had prior complaints before, right? And the problem is it's one law for the lawyers and one law for everybody else. And that's when you have no responsibility, when you have protection from prosecution, this is what happens, right? So in a way, Gershman is correct, guys. Mm-hmm. Not only was Kratz solicitizing the domestic abuse victims, he was doing the same to Stephen locked up in prison. And he had no shame.
Yeah, and employees. He was doing it to the court reporters.
In the office, correct.
Yeah, like Lynn Kaczynski kind of stuff. Meow, meow.
That's correct. That's correct.
So it starts at the top. Let's not forget, Peg Lautenschlager had a DUI.
That's correct.
It was whitewashed. While elected, I don't know if she was a DA at that time or if she was an AG. I feel like she was an AG because I feel like she wrecked in Madison coming home from an event. And she tried to talk her way out of it and it didn't work because she wrecked her car in a ditch. So when you have it from the top of course it's going to just steamroll down. And we all know about, you know, the people in Manitowoc, but I think it's clear the entirety of the Wisconsin justice system is permeated with just people who don't give a shit.
Well, that's exactly what Kathleen Zoner said. And that really would have pissed everybody off, for sure. Alice, thank you, Sunshine Christina. Alice, do you have a quick comment?
I mean, just a simple fact, Doc. That's the problem. The problem is that these fuckers know that they can get away with practically anything. And I'm not just meaning prosecutors. I'm meaning cops and other lawyers and judges and everything like that. Because especially prosecutors with a prosecutor immunity, that needs to go. It'll be refined or re-looked at. And it needs to state that if and when it comes back from an exoneree, that there has been prosecutorial misconduct, whether that's keeping back evidence, no handing it over at all, or whatever, then something can happen to them. Because this is one of the biggest problems. I mean, last year there was over, 248 exonerations? And it was all due to prosecutor misconduct. Because they withheld evidence, they tampered with evidence, they didn't even bother to hand it over and stuff like that. So this is a big problem. But because nobody's giving a fuck about it, they're getting away with it, left, right, and centre. I guarantee you that if something happens and a new law was to pass, and it was about prosecutors who do misconduct, no matter what that misconduct is, whether it's sexual misconduct, whether it's no handing over documents or whatever. You know what I mean? If they know that they are going to get sent to jail, they're going to do time, they're going to lose their pensions, they're going to lose their license, everything like that. I guarantee you, a lot of them wouldn't do half the shit that they would be doing, and people would start getting a fair shake at trial, because the way things are the new, it is not fair. It is not fair on the defendant when prosecutors can do this stuff and get away with it. It's just no right.
Correct.
Thank you, Alice.
Yep. Thank you, Alice, for your passion and honesty.
Yeah, and for saying that it's not right, because life is not fair. That's a fact. Life is just not fair. But this is not right. And correct me if I'm wrong, but wouldn't these officials who are thumping on the book of law and justice, wouldn't it be only logical that they are actually being held at a higher standard, not lower, but a higher, to lead by example,
not to do
the criminal actually acts and profit from it. Well, and they're being just hiding behind the shield of, you know, I can't even say the bar, because Kratz he never passed the bar. He's a diploma privilege lawyer.
Yeah, it's almost mutual. What's it called? They're all hiding behind the, if I go down, I'm bringing you with me. You know what I mean? So nobody rats on Kratz because he's got all their secrets. And there's a saying somewhere, with great power comes great responsibility. Right? Okay. Yeah, and if those in power are acting irresponsible, those who are under their power are going to suffer as a result. And this case is the perfect example of that.
It is.
Yeah, but not only that, it's the fact that they say nobody is above the law. Nobody. But when it comes to these cases, all the prosecutors are above the fucking law. Because they can evidence, they can no hand it over, they can set somebody up and around like that, and nothing happens to them. And that is one of the biggest problems of you know what I mean? It is the major issue in all of these
And the issue, yeah. And the problem is you expose. So let's say, which I pray this happens. Let's say Stephen Avery's exonerated and they expose everything that was done in this case. You know what comes next, right? Any case, any of them have touched, that they yes. are able to show that they had a hand in wrongfully convicting yep. Stephen and Brendan. Any case they touch is automatically, it has to go up on appeal. And I'm going to say one other thing and then I'm going to mute. I think about when Making a Murderer was first released, where the president at the time made a point to say, I can't do anything for him. It's a state case. But yet, when we had someone wrongfully detained they weren't wrongfully detained. When we had someone who committed a crime in Russia and was sentenced to prison, they traded a known weapons dealer to get back someone who rightfully was in prison, maybe ridiculously sentenced, but she committed a crime, right? We got her back and gave up a guy who was doing way worse than her to do that. But yeah, yet he couldn't use his power to get these two guys out of prison.
It's a federal crime. It's a federal crime. That's the difference.
It doesn't matter.
It does.
The president, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. We are taught the president can do whatever he wants for the good of the country, correct? So that it's good for the country to get back someone who committed a crime, but not good for the country to release two, and not just Stephen and Brendan, all the innocent people everyone knows is innocent, but the red tape didn't keep her over there. But it's sure keeping Stephen and Brendan sitting in prison rotting away for something they didn't do, while everyone else is, you know, out playing golf and fishing.
You know what makes this worse? That's okay. Just briefly before we start back reading, you know, what makes this worse? You know, listen to Alice and Christina talk about these various things that these prosecutors have gotten away with. In Wisconsin, as we well know, they have the OLR, the Office of Lawyer Review. So if something did get, you know, brought to them, like did in Kratz's situation, instead of him going through the regular criminal process like Stephen or whoever else, they get handed off to the OLR and they handle the case. It's complete it's complete bullshit. It's two sets of rules.
That's correct. And the only thing there's a couple of points, and Sancho and Christina touched on a very important point. And that is that if Stephen and Brendan get exonerated, then potentially people are going to start looking at all the cases that Kratz, Fallon, and Norm Garn and the Wisconsin State Crime Lab became involved in. And that's exactly what the civil suit was all about, right? Had Stephen won that civil suit, then they would have been looking at Kasarik when he was in power, all the cases involving Cherie Cohane, her touching forensic evidence, and there could have been a lot of appeals. Don't laugh, because that's exactly what happened with those two that were handling all the drug cases. Remember Jack 61? They had to overturn 10,000 cases.
Yep.
They had to throw them out.
Yep.
And that's why they're not letting Stephen and Brendan out.
They don't want to repeat
exactly
of that.
Exactly why.
They do not want to repeat of that, 100%. Now, Neverly, I know you've got to go, so shall we continue reading? We're nearly finished.
Sure. Just one more point. Sorry, Dr. Selkman. Let us not forget that Kratz didn't only prey on women of age. He also preyed on victims of domestic violence and sexual violence as well, who were underage. And there was one, I think, 17-year-old girl who came to his office with her mother.
Kratz started
inquiring of what had happened, which, you know, That's his job. But then the way he did it was so disturbing. I was disturbed while I was reading about it.
Even the mother
And
complained.
thank God the mother complained. But you know what? The whole time that was happening between Kratz, the victim's mother, there was another woman in the office because I think that's the law that you have to have a female there. I just wonder what that female assistant knows.
Yes.
All the stories, all the questions, all the inappropriate behavior, comments, and actions. Yeah. Maybe she should
And
write a book.
well, don't worry. In the future, we're going to do exactly that chapter.
Thank
Mr.
you.
Kratz and his solicitations. Don't worry, we'll be doing that chapter in the future, I promise. All right. Neville, would you like to continue? I've got a few more pages and we're done.
Sure. But there was also something at play. There was a pattern developing. Interestingly, did I read this already? Interestingly, quite similar allegations in the disciplinary proceedings against Kratz are present in Kratz's solicitation of Avery. Thus, in the disciplinary proceedings, Kratz was found to have acted with a selfish motive, manipulated a vulnerable woman, engaged in exploitative behavior, engaged in harassing behavior, showed a crass placement of his personal interests above those of his client, and crossed the line separating the unprofessional conduct from the acutely offensive and harassing. Gershman pointed out. However, there is no indication Kratz was pursuing Avery for sexual reasons, like the women who were domestic violence victims he tried to seduce. But as a matter of professional ethics, Kratz's conduct towards Avery was intimidating, self-interested, and manipulative, as it was to the women Kratz abused. Avery was in a hopeless position. And an easy target for Kratz's
That's the key
solicitation.
point.
There you go.
That's the key
Yeah.
point. That's the key point right there. Stephen would be
Easy
going bail.
target.
And the
Yes.
women were easy victims as well. Easy targets for someone like Kratz.
Kratz knew the prison authorities had objected to Avery speaking to Kratz and that Kratz's overtures might hurt Avery. Particularly disingenuous was Kratz's ploy to suggest falsely that Kratz was simply a disinterested person trying to assist Avery to tell his story, his honest story, to the world, but knowing full well that he wanted Avery's story only if Avery told his story in a way that served Kratz's selfish interests in writing a book and promoting himself.
Boom, right there. Boom.
Kratz exploited his former status as Avery's prosecutor, who knows more about your case than anyone. Kratz disparaged Avery's continued nonsense about being set up. He intimidated Avery as he did with the women he abused, trying to convince Avery to talk to him by the veiled threat that this was too bad that Avery refused to talk to him because you had one opportunity to finally tell your details. But now that will never happen. Gershman's curriculum vitae notes that he has authored four books. He has also written about 2 dozen law review articles, including writing on litigation Brady versus Maryland, reflections on Brady versus Maryland, prosecutorial ethics and victims' rights, witness coaching by prosecutors, and the prosecutor's duty to truth.
How ironical is that?
As for Kenneth R. Kratz, the Wisconsin Bar Association online directory indicates he graduated from Marquette University's law school in 1985 and was admitted to practice law in Wisconsin on May 20, 1985. But as of November 2018, the Wisconsin Bar Association listed Kratz's law license as being suspended for three different reasons: dues, CLE, continuing legal education, and for OLR certification. The Office of Lawyer Regulation was an agency with the Wisconsin Supreme Court. The website domain on file with the Wisconsin Bar Association for the Kratz Law Firm was also for sale.
Wow. Everything went wrong for poor Mr. Kratz, right?
Yes, everything. Poor Mr. Kratz.
Correct. So actually, that's the end of the chapter. We actually made it. And for those who like to delve deeper into this chapter, you can see that what John Farrakh does is he leaves footnotes. And if, like I said, the Foul Play team has done a couple of podcasts involving Gershman. There was a Powder Puff episode in which the girls went over Gershman's affidavit in fine detail. Neverly was on that panel as well, I believe. Is that correct, Neverly? You were there.
Yes.
BB and a few of the other ladies were on there as well. It was a really, really good discussion. Now, does anyone have any comments before we finish off the podcast? In fact, we've got to thank all the people in chat. We've had a huge number of people who would like to read out who's actually in chat. Who would like to tell us who's in chat? Oh, Jack61.
I can.
Who's in chat?
Well, let's just go through. We've got Andy B, and I see Behind the Magic. Joey Shirley, has been apparently a long-time listener, but had to, they moved and some other things and hadn't got to listen in a while, but they're back, so we appreciate
Welcome.
That. Yep, absolutely.
Welcome.
We got Clive Coolidge and, of course, Travis. Really appreciate his legal wisdom coming in and speaking.
Fantastic comments. Yeah,
absolutely. I'm scrolling. Wow, a lot of comments tonight. Of course, we have the lovely Dark Side of the Moon and Katniss, Graham Moss, Gloria, Jamie, of course, popped in. Thanks, Jamie, for coming. He's on the road. Still need to get that on the road video stuff started there, buddy. But that'd be fun. Who else we got here? We have...
I saw Hugh Fraser under your scars. We've got...
Marty H. There's Colette. Jason Bennett.
We've got Gloria. Yeah, Jason Bennett. We've got Tuco.
Checking Convections was in earlier.
Kay came. Kay and I saw another one here. Go ahead if you see somebody I haven't met.
We got TJ Anderson. I think we called out everybody's name. And thank you so much for joining us. And unless anyone's got any comments, Jack61, we have a short little video clip to play. Is that correct?
Which one is it?
This is on page 28, entitled Who is the Real Psychopath?
Oh, I forgot about that one. You're going to have to give me a second. Hold on just a second. You guys talk.
Yep. Neverly, do you have any comments?
My comment is that as aggravating as this was to read, it really triggers a lot of people. We understand that.
Shocker. Yeah. It's a shocker.
It's like, I don't know. You almost become speechless. Just speechless. We know that things happen, that the world is not fair, the world is not right, that things happen, that there's manipulation, that there's money, you know, and there's power and prestige and, you know, goals and accolades and all that. But man, oh man.
But the amazing thing which I've learned from this is that it was a relentless pursuit of Stephen Avery by Ken Kratz. And it reminds me very much of the relentless pursuit of Brendan Dassey by Brad Schimmel. Brad Schimmel would not let go. Right, guys?
He
would not let go. Same with Mr. Kratz. He still won't let go. And so we've got this little meme clip that I put together entitled Who is the Real Psychopath? It only goes for a couple of minutes. Jack61, do people have to mute in Discord?
They'll have to unmute YouTube. to be able to hear this from YouTube that I'm going to play. So I'm ready whenever you guys are. Ready to go?
Yeah, let's go for it.
All right. Here we go.
We speak with former prosecutor Ken Kratz, who's written a new book which reveals his provocative theory that Stephen Avery made himself a murderer.
Stephen Avery started planning this event the very first day he went to prison.
Kratz tells Dateline he believes Stephen Avery had set his sights on Teresa Halbach in the weeks leading up to her murder.
As we move closer towards October 31st, we see Stephen's behavior changing. He starts making calls directly to Teresa Halbach rather than going through Auto Trader.
Why would Stephen Avery do this when he was on the verge of getting this big windfall, potentially millions of dollars?
That's a great question. You know, I don't know. We know that he's a psychopath. We know that he has...
Do we know that?
Well, I let's say I allege that, okay? I believe that deep down.
You paint a very damning picture of Stephen. You bring up previous allegations of sexual assault and rape, none of which were ever prosecuted. This seems to have really been a personal case for you, at least became a personal case for you. Looking back, do you think you could have approached this from a more professional standpoint as opposed to not characterizing Stephen in certain ways that you have?
These are all observations that I made well after the fact, after he was convicted.
Did you think so at the time?
Oh, I thought that he was a bad guy in the sense of he certainly had violence against women histories. He had injured just about everybody that he was ever in a relationship with. And so the characterization at the time, knowing that he's violent, that doesn't make him a murderer, of course, but it isn't too far of a characterization or a determination of what I think he is now, which I would suggest was a psychopath.
He's like a moth to the flame, and he just cannot stay away from the case. And the more he talks, the more ammunition he's giving us, because he's made so many statements that are just false.
Are you afraid of Kathleen Zellner?
No, I'm not involved in the case anymore. I shouldn't be afraid of anything. My involvement concluded.
She could unravel your work if what she's saying has some weight to it. You don't think she has a chance?
I don't.
Just wow. Sometimes, you know, sometimes a little clip like that is worth a million words, right? And the biggest enemy of Mr. Kratz is Mr. Kratz. Alice, do you have a comment?
Absolutely. You said it right there.
Yeah. Casey was spot on. The biggest enemy to him is him. But, I mean, he sent a man to jail for life, for murder. And instead, in every interview, instead of saying, "The evidence proves that Stephen Avery did this," it's my speculation, my opinion. Well, it shouldn't have been done on your fucking opinion. It should have been done on evidence and fact, you fucking fanny.
Well, the problem all along, Alice, and thank you so much for your comment, was that the case against Stephen was circumstantial, right? Clearly, they could not bring in Brendan Dassey, because Brendan Dassey's so-called coerced confession is full of holes, and you could drive a truck through it, right? So Stephen's case was tried on circumstantial conditions. I really wonder now what the jury must be thinking after all this analysis that's been done. They must be looking back and wondering how the hell we got sucked in. Because remember, the initial count was 7 not guilty, 3 were undecided, and I think 1 or 2 said guilty. So there was a massive turnaround. But despite, as Jack 61 alluded to, despite all the material that was not shown to the jury, 7 came back as not guilty initially, right? That is damning in itself, right? But I love the little clip. It goes to show the utter desperation that Ken Kratz has. Now, let's think about it. He successfully prosecuted Stephen and Brendan. What on earth is he still pursuing Stephen? It doesn't make any sense, guys. Does anyone have any final comments? Jack 61.
It is almost like a mental tick or something, because, you know, he got himself wrapped up so deeply in this investigation and prosecution of these two cases, and then this path of destruction that he got on, however he got on it, you know, we'll never really know the outside of the courtroom his real life interactions, at least not all of it. We know some of it, and the disgusting things that he did, and I call them disgusting. Maybe to other people that's really nothing, but to me, the actions that he did towards other women and some of the things he did were, I feel 100% convinced in saying this. Of course, it's an allegation, speculation, that there's many more that we never heard about. These women never came forward and said anything. I think that probably happened for sure. But then, you know, we travel on to 7008 and 9, and we get into a lot of the things that we found out from the DOJ, this big back and forth he had with them. He was able to basically get these cases buried until Ryan Foley, like I said earlier, did an open records request, and they released the information. And then he's, you know, he was trying to make some kind of political statement about all of it. It's crazy what he did. It really is mental to me. And then, even after all that, he continues on pursuing. We've seen the dates that the slide the doc prepared in Neverly, 2013, 2015. He's still pursuing Brendan and Steve.
Yes.
Or Stephen,
yes.
I mean.
Yes.
That's 8 years after the fact, after he sent them to prison.
That's right.
Or should we say 10 years after the whole fiasco?
Correct. Now, look, guys, we're going to finish the podcast very soon, but I want to just make the statement that I consider mental health absolutely no joke matter. But this is truly remarkable. And so what I would like is to go through, can you put up slide 29, Jack 61? And Neverly, do you have still time to read through the slide?
Absolutely. Okay. One more thing, Dr. Selkman. The whole time that the little video was playing, and what a gem it is, as disturbing as it is, it's a real gem. While Mr. Kratz's lips were moving, and while he was alleging all these horrible things about Stephen Avery, when you think about it, it sounded to me, at least, as if he was describing himself.
100%. And this is why I've got the following two slides. I'm going to ask some serious questions. I want everyone in the panel to unmute and everyone in chat to say yes or no to each of the questions. Right? So everyone unmute, guys, who's on the panel. And after Neverly reads each statement, I want you to say yes or no. Neverly, you want to start?
Got it.
So, yeah, so this is the medical definition of a narcissistic personality disorder. Neverly, you want to start?
Sure. Narcissistic personality disorder. Symptoms. Signs and symptoms of narcissistic personality disorder and the severity of symptoms vary. People with the disorder can have an exaggerated sense of self-importance.
Yes.
Have a sense of entitlement and require constant, excessive admiration.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Yes. expect to be recognized as superior even without achievements that warrant it.
Yes.
Or
exaggerate achievements and talents.
Oh my God, yes.
Yes.
Be preoccupied with fantasies about success, power, brilliance, beauty, or the perfect mate. Oh my
yes.
God.
Yes.
Surprise.
Yes.
Surprise.
Yes.
I think you knocked that one out of the park.
You know what, guys, before we continue, you know, we should have got Optus as a sponsor because Optus's bar line is yes, Optus. We missed out on a good opportunity there. Neville, continue.
Sure. Believe they're superior and can only associate with equally special people.
Oh, yes.
Special district attorney, right?
Yep.
Monopolize conversations and belittle or look down on people they perceive as inferior. Oh, my God. You mean like Stephen Avery?
Nailed
the domestic victims?
Nailed to the cross.
Yes.
Expect special favors and unquestioning compliance with their expectations.
Yes.
Oh, my.
Yes.
Take advantage of others to get what they want.
Constantly, wow. Yes.
Yes. It's a double yes.
Have an inability or unwillingness to recognize the needs and feelings of others.
Yep. Oh, yes. He has no empathy. He has zero empathy.
Check this one out. Be envious of others and believe others envy them.
Yes.
Huge. Huge.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. That's 11. That's probably the only A plus he's ever got.
Oh, there's more. That's right.
But wait.
That's the only full score he got in his car, but there's more.
But
number 30.
There's more.
But wait, there's more.
Behave in an arrogant or haughty manner, coming across as conceited, boastful, and pretentious. No.
Yeah. Yes.
Not crass. Insist on having the best of everything. For instance, the best car or office.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Or the big sandbox and $350,000 house.
Yeah, that's what I was correct. Just thinking, Neverly.
At the same time, people with narcissistic personality disorder have trouble handling anything they perceive as criticism, and they can become impatient or angry when they don't receive special treatment.
Yeah.
That's a triple yes, Doc.
Like when you ask Rookie if he was smoking crack. Yeah.
Yes.
Or Ryan, or what was the reporter's name that he tried to belittle?
Ryan Foley.
Yep.
Foley. Ryan Foley.
Have significant interpersonal problems and easily feel slighted.
Yeah. Yes.
You would think four marriages? Yeah. React with rage or contempt and try to belittle the other person to make themselves appear superior. Oh my gosh. Yeah. This is like the hallmark.
The Ryan Foley interview is hallmark of that.
Yep, triple yes.
Have difficulty regulating emotions and behavior. Yep.
Yes. Yes.
Yep. Experience major problems dealing with stress and adapting to change.
Yes.
Feel depressed and moody because they fall short of perfection. Oh my God, dude.
Yes.
He's so far from perfection, eating corn dogs on the couch. Remember when he hooked up with somebody online and the girl, like a dating site, and she was all into outdoorsy stuff, hiking, biking, triathlons and stuff. He goes, no, I mostly sit on my couch and eat corn dogs. That's what he said.
Yep.
Correct.
Have secret feelings of insecurity, shame, vulnerability, and humiliation. And this, my friends, is it. This is the rabbit hole of narcissistic personality disorder. This is the cause of the narcissistic personality disorder. The shame, insecurity, humiliation, and vulnerability.
100% correct. And you know what's even scary? that poor Stephen and Brendan ran into him.
Oh,
with
yeah.
All these issues. And he's, and as someone said, this is the only time he scored a perfect 30 out of 30 on the uh-huh. scorecard. He, if a psychologist was interviewing Kratz, he would have closed the door and written a book on him. It's as simple as that, because he is the perfect narcissist. Alice, do you have a comment?
Everybody in chat, it was all yeses to every single one that we read out. And we've got about 55 in chat, and they're all like, yes, 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 with everyone that we mentioned. So, and Yoga for the Ageless, hi Yoga, says, okay, now that we've discussed his good points, can we look at his bad ones?
What about what Andy B wrote?
What do you think?
I've just been to the toilet. Are you talking about me? That's a classic, that one. Correct. Jackson, thank you, Alice. Do you have a comment?
Oh, no.
Sorry.
Everybody good? Well, look, guys, before we go on to the last slide, I'd just like to thank everyone in chat for a fantastic end to this particular chapter in John Farrakh's book. And as you can see, we're incredibly interactive on the Foul Play team. And it was a difficult chapter to get through, right, Neville? It was a very hard one to read.
Yes.
But we needed to do it. We're the only team that has gone through Mr. Kratz's book, the entire chapter. And like I said, Susan read both versions and worked out the differences between both editions. I promise we will cover that in a podcast. I promise to do that, because it's very interesting what Mr. Kratz does. But if you have enjoyed our podcast, please give us a thumbs up. And look, tell someone about the Foul Play team. Let them know that we exist, because I believe that we do really good professional work here. We've got a whole team of very passionate people. We do this for free. Any income we generate, we give it to a worthy cause, and we use money to get 4 years to put into our library, right? So it's your support. In fact, Jack61, we even picked up 10 more subscribers, which is fantastic.
So yeah, please like the video, subscribe and share. The more the merrier. We're all in this together, and teamwork is teamwork.
And our goal is the truth. That's our goal. That's our only goal. There's nothing else. We don't have a motive to say anything other than the truth. Everything on the table, let's look through it and see what the real story is, because what happened at trial is not the real story. I promise you that.
No. No, and Mr. Kratz's actions confirm it. He's got no idea what happened to Teresa Halbach. Right? He's got no idea. And he was so desperate to talk to Stephen to find out. And Stephen has always maintained his innocence, right? And we have questioned the forensic evidence used against Stephen. And it's shocking. And I don't know about the other panel members, but I've been following a couple of the cases that are happening at the moment, which are insane. The Anna Walsh case, the Idaho 4, which is truly incredibly insane as well. Alec Murdoch case.
Oh, my God.
The Alec Murdoch case is just phenomenal. And I think there's one more. Can you help me out, Neville? I think there's another big major case. We talked about the Idaho 4, Alec Murdoch.
And Anna Walsh.
Anna Walsh, they're the three big ones.
And the Vallow, and can never think of her name. The two kids that got killed.
What is her name? The woman who thought she was a. Yeah, that's a weird one.
Yeah. And, something Vallow.
The reason why I'm following those cases is to see the differences in how the prosecuting attorneys handle themselves and what they say to the public, et cetera, et cetera. And you then compare to what happened to poor Stephen and Brendan. It was a terrible, terrible shit show. a lack of professionalism. And then Mr. Kratz has the gall to say, oh yeah, I wanted to contact Stephen to get the truth out. That just simply mind-blowing.
And you know what, you guys? We haven't heard something like that coming out of Mr. Gunn and Mr. Fallon's mouths, have we?
No.
Because they're smart enough. They have some self-control to know when to stop.
They're too busy giving away cremains to the Horvath family.
True, true. And going on sabbaticals,
yeah.
And going to the sabbaticals. What about guys?
Oh, I was just going to say, it is interesting. The few times that they have spoken on the case have been in, because they are, well, at the time that they spoke, they were representing the state. And even their attempts to discuss the case only supplied more evidence of the intentional wrongful conviction. Even those guys can't conduct themselves ethically in this case because it's such a blatant intentional wrongful conviction. You know, think about the emails that we have from Gunn where he wants to go to the clandestine burial site. Fallon and the voicemail that his buddy left on KZ's answering machine when he thought he was talking to Fallon, where they were obviously trying to blow her off and be sly about doing it.
Correct, 100% correct. So it's very interesting to see, especially these new cases. I'm more interested per se in the forensic evidence as well. And I've been following...
Oh, you? You, Dr. Silkman?
Yeah,
show I've been following... Show us the shirt.
My shirt? Oh, we'll have to get Jack61 to put me on camera.
Oh, yeah, sure. Well, also, while I'm doing that, Doc, the behavior of the prosecutors as well in these cases is really key, because the behavior of how Kratz acted really pretty much for a year or more in the Avery case versus what we see in these other cases is it's completely different. It's contrary. It's 180.
100% correct. What's remarkable is how restrained all the prosecutors are and what they say. They're very, very, very careful. And so here's my shirt over here. Forensic gangster.
There you go.
And and I've been going on the chats of some of these big, big YouTubers. And I even asked a couple of questions as well. And one of my questions got answered. And there were like 2,000 people in the chat. Absolutely amazing. So what I'm going to do, Jack61, if we can have the final slide for me before we go around the table. Next week, we've got a treat for you guys. So we're going to put aside Farak's reading with the crew. And so what I would like to do, I'll just wait for Jack61 to put up the slide. We're going to do a special treat. Now, a lot of you guys may have heard about the use of the MVAC system. It's a new crime-fighting tool. And a lot of the cases at the moment, they're talking about the MVAC, but a lot of people don't really understand what the technique's all about and how it can be used in solving crimes. So I've put together a special treat for you guys. So next week at this time slot, we're going to do a round the table live discussion, right? I'm not going to do a pre-recording and all that sort of stuff. We're going to do a live discussion about the MVAC system. And we're going to ask a very important question here. And that is, can the MVAC system recover crucial trace DNA evidence in the 2005 murder of Teresa Horvath? And so what we'll do live, we'll talk about the technique. We'll talk about the technique of the MVAC, what it's used for, how it works. so you guys can get up to date with this incredibly new technique. And I'm amazed that not law enforcement officers are using this technique. And then we'll have a look at some forensic pieces of evidence from the Horbach case that will blow your mind. Absolutely blow your mind. And they'll be perfect for the use of the MVAC system. So, guys, I'm really excited. Like I said, it's going to be an informal chat. We're going to put up some pictures and we'll just do a round the table discussion. I'm not going to do a pre-recording or anything like that. But as it goes, right? But let me know if you think that's a good idea. I'd love to see you all next week on this very special podcast. And if there's anything that you would like that for us to do, for us to examine, because like I said, my forte is in DNA, molecular biology techniques. So if there's anything in the crime-fighting field that you're interested in, because it's amazing how a lot of these big YouTubers that discuss the murder trials, they all bring on specialists, right? Forensic specialists, specialists in this, specialists in that. Well, bugger that. We've got our own specialist here, right?
That's right. So
if there's anything that you want to know, put down your questions and I'll see if we can answer them or I can answer them, because the MVAC system is going to play a crucial role, especially in the Idaho 4 case, right, for picking up trace DNA elements. And I'm telling you right now, if Kathleen Zellner gets a hand on the RAV4, I'm going to write to her personally that she needs to get the whole thing, everything MVAC'd, because it would tell a story that's hiding, as I showed in the slide, in plain sight. The answers are there, right? She just needs to get access to that RAV. Well, look, guys, thank you so much. Now, what we'll do, we'll quickly go around the table, tell us how you've been coming along and what's been happening. Jack 61.
Doing very well. Thank you very much, Doc. Just been doing our normal thing. Still looking at various things that we can do open records requests with that we don't have, that we've had difficulty. Still working on a few things from that standpoint. And look at some other things that we could potentially get that that are less apparent. It's like I know that Jinx is made a request to get the ledgers from the DOJ, their ledgers, like we got the, Seeking Truth got the queso ledgers. It would be really nice to have those ledgers to find out what they actually have, what they actually, they have their own like audio and stuff like that, that we've seen, but we don't have a full accounting and we should be able to get that. There's absolutely no reason that this shouldn't be released. So, and I also need to mention, we preempted a couple of times last week with the new filing from KZ, which I thought was that was a really interesting podcast that we had, reading her reply to this. It was really good.
It was a ripper.
So, we preempted Rhonda's normal weekly, so. She asked me if she could go on tomorrow instead of us doing the open mic, and I said yes. So Rhonda's going to get back and do what she was going to do on Thursday, because we preempted her tomorrow, and the open mic has been moved to Wednesday, and we'll be going to part two of William Beck's deposition, which was really interesting. If you remember, you remember we were talking about the photograph that Kasorik had written on the back,
safe.
Yep. That's right.
Correct.
So that's kind of where we're at, and keep on keeping on.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Jack 61. Alice, what about yourself?
All good, Doc. I was in the chat for a podcast for Luke's case. The other day, Tuesday, the James English podcast, and he's got a really high viewer content, and we had 1,000 people in the chat, which was great. It was going that fast. I mean, if we ever get that, it was hard the other night there when we had 99 in chat, trying to keep up with the chat because it was going so fast. So we would need to put on slow mode if we get that amount of people in our chat. But the great thing awesome. About it, yeah, the great thing about it though was, Doc, that was that the majority, I'm not saying all of them, but the majority of them believe that Luke is innocent, which is absolutely brilliant. I mean, Sandra Lean has been fighting this case for the last 19 years, you know.
Huge.
And at one point, she was doing it herself. It was just her on the case. She had other people in the background, but it was her that was out there facing the public, doing interviews.
That was savage.
Yeah.
That was savage.
They still are. I mean, that woman's been spat on. She's been pushed in front of cars. She's been attacked at her own front door. She has been attacked. Yeah. Somebody threatening her. No attack, but somebody going up and threatening her and saying, because they had a website and it was they went up to her door and they basically told her, take that website down or else I know where you stay. You know what I mean? So to me, that is a verbal attack, you know. So for the amount of people that are coming out now and believing in Luke's innocence is absolutely fantastic. It is absolutely fantastic.
Sorry to interrupt. Sorry? You know what? Could you imagine the MVAC system on that forensic evidence?
On whatever forensic evidence left, Doc, because they've destroyed, they've been destroying evidence since November 2020. If I remember right, there was an article, and that's just came out. Luke's legal team have just found this out, that they started destroying evidence, and it's not just paperwork, it's the fingernail scrapings belonging to Jodie, knives that they said that are missing, that aren't actually missing, that are in police custody, you know, but they did the narrative about, oh, Luke was hiding knives and everything like that. He was a knife fiend and everything like that. There's medical reports of Jodie's brother and things like that, you know, that wasn't handed over to the defence. So all these things are coming out now, and there is a lot more people that are getting into the case. And I think it's absolutely fantastic that now people are starting to believe Sandra and all her hard work. So I would just like to say, Sandra, we love you. You have done a fantastic job. And I will get back to doing videos soon, hopefully. There's something wrong with the computer just now, so I need to get that sorted. But hopefully I'm going to get back to doing videos and everything like that, just to keep his story going, because the more that's coming out, it's ridiculous, you know. And the fact that police are destroying evidence, and the Lord Advocate.
Yeah.
Well, the worst thing about it, Doc, is the people that we need to go to go above the Court of Appeals is the Lord Advocate, right? And the Lord Advocate then decides whether it goes back for an appeal or not. Well, the Lord Advocate has came back and said that there is no basis for Luke's case to be reviewed, even though but she's the one that gave the police the permission to destroy the evidence. But the kicker in that is she is the wife of the prosecutor who prosecuted Luke in the first place, who is now saying that there is no basis for a review. You know, that shouldn't be allowed. She shouldn't be anywhere near that case. We've got umpteen Lord Advocates in this country, you know what I mean? So a different Lord Advocate should have took over that case, not her. The wife of the prosecutor that prosecuted Luke, you know?
Yeah,
it's just not.
It's very much the Stephen Avery case in your country. It's an absolute shock. Absolute shocker.
It's Scotland's biggest shame, Doc. It is our biggest shame and miscarriage of justice.
Yep. And also, guys, I was fortunate enough to interview Dr. Sandra Lean and that on a podcast, and that went really, really well. Learned a lot. We got viewer questions. We got questions on the panel, and it was an incredible, incredible podcast. And one day I've got to do a part two. I'll ask her some more questions. And I know that she's a very, very busy person. But thank you so much, Alice. I appreciate that very much. Next, we have I Don't Recall. How are you coming along?
Pretty well. I'm just working, and right now I'm helping Rhonda get ready for the her next podcast, I guess, tomorrow night. So awesome. Working on that.
Thank you so much, I Don't Recall. Next, we have Susan.
Oh, you're really guitaring. You're really guitaring, Susan.
Oh, you're guitaring.
Sorry.
We might get back to Susan. Next, we have Sunshine Christina.
Hi. Just the same old, trying to follow up on, I have some open records requests out with the Wisconsin DOC on some other inmates, and I'm waiting, I'm in discussions with them and waiting for them to get supplied to me, and then I have a few other requests that the DOJ gives me the canned response to once a month that I'm getting tired of waiting on, that I'm going to try and at least get them to give me a time for the release.
Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to getting the crime theory exchange back to rolling. I'm shooting for maybe the middle of February, I think. That'll give us all some time to kind of get situated, and hopefully things will calm down. But I missed the KZ open mic, but I read through her filing, and I think that like y'all were saying, it's one of the best ones we've seen. I feel like she's giving the state the rope to hang themselves. I just think that she's playing a long game against people who are only trying to play short term. And each filing that they make just gives her an opportunity to add more stuff to the record. So, I'm hopeful.
I thought her response was fantastic. It was poignant. No mucking around, written beautifully. Let's see how the state handles that one. Thank you, Sunshine Christina. And finally, we have Neveli. Neveli.
Hello, Dr. Selkman. First of all, I would like to thank you. And I want you to know that we feel really privileged to be in a team where we have, I know that you are humble and all of that, but I would like just to acknowledge the fact that we have our very own DNA specialist who is a match to any. I've been watching so many YouTube videos, and they have all these experts, and they have investigators, they have science, actually not very many scientists. So that's too bad, because we have our very own. So thank you for that. And we appreciate you.
We appreciate one of you guys. There's no way I could do it by myself, and I wouldn't want to. I love the our group is so complementary, and everyone's got their own strengths, right, and talents, and we're all together as the Foul Play team. And the more exposure we can get, more people that can get to hear about it, because we have a massive body of work done already. I think Jack 61, we've got over 2,700 videos or something like that on our YouTube channel.
Yep.
Which is a phenomenal amount of work. So,
Yeah, so I started following the Murdoch case, and you guys, I don't know if you're familiar with it or not. If not, please grab some time to do so, to kind of, it just started, and there's that really good depiction of the Murdoch family located in South Carolina, the Low Country of South Carolina. And what it means when a powerful family rules the whole, not one county, but five. It kind of reminded me of Wisconsin, where Stephen and Brandon live, Manitowoc, because in South Carolina with Murdochs, they have a case of generational lawyers, solicitors, four generations, so almost 100 years. Of solicitors in one family. So imagine the power. Imagine the money.
Huge.
Yeah, so it kind of reminded me of generational cops in that area in Wisconsin, Manitowoc, Calumet, and so forth, because it's very hard to stand up against that. Very hard.
I would say impossible. Objection 1.
Yeah, just briefly, because I was talking to Neverly about this case the other day, and I actually tuned it in after we talked, Neverly, on Law and Crime. And they were going through the evidence. They had, the lab tech on the stand, and they were opening and
In the middle trial? Yes.
That's right.
The lady that took out all the evidence from the boxes. And
one by one?
Yep.
Phenomenal. Yep. Phenomenal. Yep.
They're verifying that, but this is really easy. Neverly, how quickly did that Murdoch name get destroyed? How quick did that happen?
Well, that happened pretty much once he got caught. For one thing, it was like a snowball effect, and the whole Murdoch dynasty fell apart with this one man, Alex Murdoch, in 1 year. But up until then, they ruled the five counties, not one, but five. Imagine the stretch. For, I think, 90 years, 89 years or something like that. And this guy put it all to a stop. The whole dynasty, the ruling of one family came to a stop. He was indicted over 90 counts. And that's without the double murder.
Yep, correct. So he's going to be in front of a judge for a long, long period of time. Yeah. It's a shocking, shocking, shocking case. I think, Jexis One, did you show the documentary on Foul Play, stream the documentary?
I did. I did stream that. It's insane. And you know, what Neverly is saying, I mean, I guess it's a little hard to comprehend for us that haven't lived in a region like that, but I can visualize it. This one family, and that youngest kid, that son, he was, you could tell he had no boundaries. What little bit, we're only getting little snapshots of time, with this kid, but there was absolutely no boundaries for this kid. It's mind blowing. That's all I can say, Doc.
Yeah, but before making a murderer, I would take prosecution's word for gospel. I thought that was nothing but the truth, because how could the state's prosecutors lie, embellish, twist, manipulate, right? I was so naive. Ever since this trial, Stephen Avery trial and Brandon Nassy, now I sit back and I take everything with a grain of salt, and I just watch the proceedings. So they were opening statements done, I think, on Wednesday of last week in the Murdoch trial, and the prosecution came out with like guns blazing. Oh my gosh, it was so graphic, it was dynamic, it was theatrical. But guess what? The defense comes out and tops that. So, it was like as I was going like, oh my god, while the prosecution was stating their case in chief, I was like, oh my God, he's guilty. But then when the defense came out, I'm like, oh yeah, well, yeah, that makes sense. You know what I mean? So the truth is probably somewhere in between. So we shall see. It's going to be a tight battle. Like, yeah.
It'll be a very, very interesting case to follow. That is for sure. And we also like to welcome Mark Hodinott.
Oh, hi, Mark.
Bob. Hey, Mark.
And Bob joins the chat, has joined the chat as well. We've got Yoga for the Ageless as well. Well, look, guys, we've had an incredible podcast as per usual, and I hope that you've enjoyed the podcast and you enjoy what we've done. Please give us a thumbs up and subscribe if you're new to the channel. Let others know of the Foul Play team. And like I said, next week, special treat, we'll talk about the MVAC system and whether it can uncover critical clues in the Teresa Horbart case. That's all from me, guys. And again, I'd like to thank all my fellow panel members for their passion and enthusiasm. And guys, we'll see you all very, very soon. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. And this has been a Foul Play Production.